What's up? What's up? California love.
How y'all like this Versace hookup? The swap meet was closed, so you know I go all out for the Grammys. Y'all down with this? We're gonna try to liven it up. You know how the Grammys used to be, all straight looking folks with suits, everybody looking tired, no surprises. We tired of that. We need something different, something new. We need to shock the people. So let's shock the people. Now, these my homeboys, and I seen just about everything now.
All right. Now, what are we talking about?
Well, we're talking about that Kiss reunion that happened in 96 that was very, very short-lived.
All right. I'm accompanying footage of Tupac Shakur at the American Music Awards, introducing them as they came out.
Thought that was the Grammys, not the American Music Awards.
Whatever. I don't know. It's like a place.
You're like, all award shows are stupid.
Yeah, especially these days with everything that sucks so badly. I can't even imagine we have award shows anymore. I did have some notes, though. I wanted to talk about this because this is around the time that all these bands, they stopped really kind of meaning anything, and it all became about nostalgia. And I figured nostalgia was the best way to go with that.
I'm trying to debunk your argument, but a lot of the bands I liked around that time, I mean,
they started coming back in droves. Well, we started seeing it, I think, in the 90s, right? When all these bands that were really popular in the 70s and then disappeared during the 80s suddenly had these incredible resurgences in the 90s.
Yeah, you know what? Styx was one of them. I remember South Park brought Styx back. Styx got back together and like...
Did they, with Cartman singing?
Yeah, that was
Come
one of the
sail away.
Yeah, because Styx got back together in 96, and I was there. I saw them play at the Rosemont Horizon that year.
Oh.
Yeah, saw them play over there at Rosemont Horizon, original lineup, minus John Panazzo. He died.
John Panazzo, but, yeah.
Saw Styx play at the Allstate Arena in 96.
Well, they I had no idea you were such a Styx nerd.
Oh, dude, I used to love Styx. I still love Styx. It's just like then I discovered Rush, and then it was all over from there.
Right, right. well, I was thinking about, okay, like, remember Fleetwood Mac? Fleetwood Mac disappeared, and then they came back.
And then they came back with the dance. The Eagles disappeared and came back with Hell Freezes Over.
Exactly, yeah. And a couple other bands like that. Now you have this kind of traveling roadshow of revivals and all that.
Yeah, like I saw Aerosmith '97, but they never went away. I mean, they were still popular.
Aerosmith got really big. Yeah, when they came back under their new contract with Geffen.
Yeah,
not the first record, of course. Done with Mirrors.
Yeah,
that didn't do very well. Joe Perry comes back. They do Permanent Vacation, Pump, and Get a Grip. And those all three of those are like, well, Permanent Vacation was the beginning of it, but they became, you know. They became that band that we talk about. And then there's Maud, you know, they have the big outfits on, very colorful. And it's kind of like power ballad rock, you know?
Yeah, but it worked. I mean, ironically enough, Kiss used some of these songwriters that Aerosmith used. Desmond Child, Jim Vallance, all that stuff.
Right. We talked about Detroit Rock City, the movie, right?
Yep.
Which I want to
touch on just a little bit, you know, get there.
There's a song there called Nothing Can Keep Me From You, and it basically is just a rewrite of that song, I Don't Want to Miss a Thing.
Hmm.
It is like a total just variation on I Don't Want to Miss a Thing. Same writer, too.
Diane Warren. I think that was the only time Aerosmith ever used Diane Warren was for, you know, the Armageddon soundtrack. But yeah, but Kiss used them before Aerosmith fucking did.
Yeah.
So
they did. Yeah. I mean, Diane Warren was always there. Diane Warren, didn't she actually, was it Heart? That Heart record, right? The first one on their new contract.
Oh, yeah. Alone.
Well, no, I think that was Bad Animals. But I think, didn't she write These Dreams or whatever? I don't know.
I think something like along those lines. I know she probably, of course, Heart changed their sound. Heart was a fucking, what, a 70s
yeah,
band, and then all of a
they
sudden...
They were a 70s hard rock guitar band, and they, just like Aerosmith, they went off in this direction of, you know, we call it corporate rock, I guess.
Yeah, but then Kiss did the same shit. I mean, more or less, I'd say.
Kiss, Van Halen did too. I love the song right now. No. Listen, right now was used for a Pepsi commercial, and it sold Pepsi's. That's the very definition of corporate rock, right there.
Okay, fine. You made your point.
Okay. Fine. Just want to put it out there.
Fine. I will say Kiss more or less became corporate rock around the...
Great song, though. Yeah, it's a great song.
The Crazy, Crazy Nights, Hot in the Shade era. Like, those two albums were like the most...
Turn on the Night with Snickers. Even though it's a great song. I love that. I mean, that's the whole thing. You know, I mean, like, people like to laugh at Starship, We Built This City. But the thing is, it was a huge hit. These were huge hit songs. People love them. And that's the whole point of pop music. Pop music is the stuff everybody loves, or they can't get it out of their head. You know, Beth or Forever, stuff like that, or you know, all that Aerosmith stuff. It's a consensus, right? And so what happens is, how does this lead into our conversation? Oh, we were talking about, okay, this is the beginning of, well, it's the end of the original Kiss lineup, which was. Which was what? You know, Bruce Kulick and you know
Eric Singer. And, yeah, it was basically the end of the late '80s, early '90s Kiss, like Psycho Circus. But then again, it really wasn't the end because, you know, as we all know, Psycho Circus comes out. You know, they get back together. Psycho Circus comes out. It's one of their best records in years, supposedly. I think it's an okay record. It doesn't touch.
It's an okay record.
But the problem is. Fucking like we've already said, Ace and Peter only play on one song. The rest is played by.
Hang on a second. Yep. I think the cops are here to pick me up.
Okay, they're coming to take you away. Ha ha,
ha ha, hoo hoo. Oh wait, no, they're going in a direction. No, I'm safe. They went in a different direction. You had a point you wanted to make about Detroit Rock City.
Well, yeah. Well, like I said,
when did the movie come?
Eric Singer and Tommy Thayer, I believe, played on Psycho Circus, and they've been playing on every Kiss record since. So.
Well, actually,
who played on Psycho Circus? I know Tommy Thayer played on Psycho.
It was Tommy Thayer, but you know Tommy Thayer was always there because he was like the roadie, and Eric Singer was there. I don't know if he was on the record itself. I think it was Kevin Valentine who did the drums on most of those tracks, but Bruce Kulick does appear on Psycho Circus with that really awesome backward guitar solo for Gene Simmons' song Within, which is a really great song too. I had to point that out. So he does appear there, but that's pretty much his swan song for the band. They kind of turn their back on Bruce Kulick and Eric Singer for a little bit. They bring Eric Singer back because they probably sat him down and were like, Eric, we really like you. Are you willing to put on the Peter Criss makeup and play this part? And he said, okay, sure, fine. Because Eric Singer, I guess, was a big Kiss fan when he was a kid. This is like a dream come true for him.
Yeah, and he said, you know, in interviews when, you know, the reunion happened, when Ace and Peter, they were going to go out on tour and everything, he held no ill will against them. He said, hey, look, it's Ace and Peter. I got to step down. You know, the original Fab Four getting back together, you know, for one big last hurrah, which was supposed it was supposed to be. A last hurrah. Now, 25 years later, they're doing their last hurrah. Still. But no, like that was around the time when Psycho Circus came out. About, I think Detroit Rock City came out in 1998. I did not see it in the theater, but it was
the same year as Psycho Circus coming out. So the whole thing.
Oh,
was
I know.
Like
I lied. It came out in 99. Okay, it came out in 99. I remember. Okay. 99. Because that's when I got.
So it came out a year after, and it was like the beginning of this new resurgence of the band, with the makeup on, of course, right? So, they make the record, but first we have to, I guess, talk about Psycho Circus. Now, yeah, I do like the record. I like the record. I like a lot of the songs on there, especially like I mentioned. Within, I liked Journey of a Thousand Years. I liked, Raise Your Glasses. I don't know. It's kind of cute. It's a cute song. But Ace's stuff is really the best. Into the Void is an awesome song, and it's the only song that all four of them actually play on. So I had this idea that Psycho Circus is a logical progression of the band, but not after Revenge or even after Creatures of the Night. It's a logical progression from Dynasty. It's a continuation of the band from 1979 because Dynasty was also a record where you had where they only played on one track together, and that was Dirty Living.
Right.
It was Peter Criss's song. So it's if you listen to Psycho Circus with that kind of ear, you can definitely hear that it's like a continuation of Dynasty. And it's just a little louder and harder. You know, Bruce Fairbairn produced this one, you know, under Gene and Paul's watchful eye.
Well, yeah, and of course they bring an Aerosmith's guy to frickin' come in and do this album. But then Bruce Fairbairn was...
It sounds good.
It sounds good, but Bruce Fairbairn, there was a big controversy with him back in the day, like how he almost broke up Aerosmith back in, right after the Pump, Get a Grip era. Like, that's why Aerosmith didn't do an album for 4 years. You know, it was Get a Grip and then Nine Lives, because they had this big issue with their management from Collins Management, and they had an even bigger issue with Bruce Fairbairn, and there was a lot of controversy behind that, like how Aerosmith almost broke up.
Yeah.
So
I only knew about, I guess, Get a Grip was like the last I cared about the band. You know, I don't think I cared after that.
Well, not
that was around the time I actually got their signatures.
The problem with Nine Lives, I don't want to get too far off. I do Nine Lives. Half of that record's good. The other half is trash.
Did they actually got Bruce Fairbairn to produce all those records?
The Permanent Vacation, Pump, Get a Grip. Bruce Fairbairn produced all those.
Okay, so they went back to him for those.
But then after
Pump is my favorite.
Pump is like the best
of the
three. But I'm saying
every song on Pump is awesome.
Yeah,
I love it.
Get a Grip too has. Dude, I love Get a Grip. Permanent Vacation. That's actually not one of my favorites because the album had three huge hit singles, but most of the remaining album was filler. Like it was just like these unmemorable tracks. The only standout track to me, there are two: I'm Down, which is a Beatles cover, and then fucking
Dude Looks Like a Lady,
Ragdoll, and then Angel.
That is not a CUNY.
But then Magic Touch. Ironically enough, Kiss had a song called Magic Touch, but then Aerosmith did a song called Magic Touch, and it's a really good fucking song. But then Nine Lives comes out, and it's like the front end of this album is great, but then you get to the back end of the record, and it's just like it's all filler. Like they literally shot their load in the first 30 minutes of the record.
You know what
the
I
last
think it
30
was?
Minutes just suffer.
I think it was those videos, the videos with Alicia Silverstone.
Oh yeah, like
that,
dude, that was lightning in a bottle.
Those were the ones that, yeah, because it got them a lot of exposure on MTV, and I think that's what gave the record such a long
life. Well, and on top of that, they were one of the few bands, like them and Van Halen, they survived the whole grunge, you know, grunge was happening around that time, and a lot of bands suffered because of it. Aerosmith and Van Halen, they got out alive. Kiss got out, I mean, no pun intended, Kiss got out alive. But then some really good bands, you know, some really, really good bands, you know, went by the wayside because, like I said, Queensryche, they after the grunge purge, that they were done.
Queensryche and, like I said,
Cinderella, any 80s
that.
Hair band, like unless your name was Bon Jovi.
Warrant,
Bon Jovi got lucky because, like, I remember Keep the Faith came out in like 94, and while the record did okay, it wasn't great. Like, it didn't really have.
And actually, I mean, like, even though the quality went down, dipped severely, Metallica did survive the grunge era.
Well, they were part of it because you got to remember they said within 48 days. Oh no! Wow, that horn is loud. Within like 48 days in 91, like all the same records came out. Like Nevermind came out, Pearl Jam came out, Guns N' Roses Use Your Illusion came out, Metallica's Black Album came out. They all came out in 91. So that was like a big year for all those guys, you know. Guns N' Roses would have survived had Axl Rose not been a douche nozzle.
Well, he did have a nervous breakdown and he had a divorce and he had to take care of his kid because... Yeah, there was a great article in Rolling Stone about that, how he basically became like a house dad or something and took care of his kid because Stephanie Seymour was so unreliable and all that. I can't completely blame him for that.
I guess not.
And there go the cops. The cops are looking for him.
Now right they're now. Looking for him.
So so
like a few big bands like survived that whole grunge purge. Kiss was one of them. They emerged and they put out some good shit. It's just that, you know, Psycho Circus, they kind of Aerosmith themselves a little bit, you know, like they got the dude. Let me tell you, you know, as well as I do, that is one of the most polished sounding records you're ever going to hear. It's a very polished album.
Well, that's why I was saying it had a very Dynasty feel to it, because Dynasty is a very well made record. But it's sort of like they were going in that direction. I think what it feels like, what they wanted you to feel like it was that we stopped being Kiss, the big Kiss band in 1979, and now we're going to bring it back in 1998.
But then you look at it this way, you know, you go from Dynasty to Unmasked, and Unmasked is just a steaming pie. Yeah, that album's a pile.
But they don't want you to think about
that. That album's a pile.
They don't even want you to think about that.
Like that's where it's literally that right there is like Metallica's Saint Anger. Like that album is just trash.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I'm a diehard Metallica fan, and I think
a lot of
I
people love to
trash.
Talk about Saint Anger.
I can't stand the album.
So I mean, like, but I can listen to all the songs. I just wondered where those songs were back in the non-makeup era, because there's some really good songs on that record. It's just that, and you know, it's all Gene and Paul. You know, this is it's not Kiss. I mean, it's just the Gene and Paul show. That's what they should have called it. But there is some good stuff in there, like I said, and there's a great Ace Frehley song in there that Gene Simmons wrote for him called In Your Face. It's I think it's a B-side, and it was released on the Japanese CD because, you know, they had a really big audience Japan.
They were like Spinal Tap, and they were huge.
Those were the best songs, were the Ace songs. It's interesting. And then later on, you have Sonic Boom and Monster, which were made years later. But first, I wanted to ask you, because we always got to talk about Rush.
Okay.
So this is a Rush question. Now, the final three Rush albums were Vapor Trail, Snakes and Arrows, Clockwork Angels, right? Do they honestly, and I want you to answer honestly, because I know Rush fans take an oath of honesty before they become Rush fans. It's part of the whole thing. Do they honestly compare it to the earlier stuff? You bear in mind, we don't hear those songs in the pop. We don't hear, when we talk about Rush, we don't talk about Vapor Trail, Snakes and Arrows, and Clockwork Angels. We talk about, of course, the
of
heyday.
Course.
Rush and Kiss seem to have the same trajectory because they kind of fell off a little bit. And you notice after 1996, it took them years to put out records after that, just like Kiss.
Well, there's reasons for that. We'll get it.
Do they compare? Do they compare to the earlier stuff, or is this all nostalgia?
Clockwork Angels, yes. The very last album they did is some of their best work compared to the 70s. It is comparable. I am not a fan. Vapor Trails, that album's rough. That's a rough record.
You've talked about it before,
I don't like the production value. A lot of the song. Now, don't get me wrong. I like a good, a good long Rush song. But when you start literally removing guitar solos, you know, Alex's guitar solos from it mm-hmm. it suffers. There are some good songs on that album. It's just, as a whole, it's not that great. Snakes and Arrows was a step in the right direction. I do like Snakes and Arrows a lot more than Vapor Trails. But Snakes and Arrows, it's still, there's a lot of filler on that record. But yet, the playing is a lot better. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, they're playing a lot better there.
Well, yeah, that's, I would ask, because those three records compare to the final three.
But they're not. Clockwork Angels is called the masterpiece. Like, that could have been Rush's number one album. That could have been their only number one that they would have ever had. But instead, they had to settle for number two. Because there was a rap artist who I don't even know who was out, and I think his album dropped on the same week, or it was in second week of release, and it was just more popular and sold a smidge more units than Rush did.
Kiss never had a number one record either. The closest they got was Sonic Boom. Sonic Boom made it to number two. Psycho Circus didn't even make it to number one.
But it charted higher than any other album they had since. Like, Psycho Circus was 90.
It went to number three, and then Sonic Boom went to number two, and then Monster went to number three. And well, I'll talk about Monster soon, but otherwise, I mean, like, the thing about it is, Psycho Circus, you have the quote-unquote reunion, you have the big tour. And then they didn't put out another record.
Yeah, for another 11 years or something. Like, Sonic Boom was 99, or 2009, I think, was Sonic Boom.
2009.
Well, the reason Rush didn't put out anything is because Neil's wife died. Neil's wife and daughter died.
Okay.
His daughter died in a car accident, and then his wife ended up getting breast cancer. Yeah, he literally lost his wife and daughter within, I'm going to just roughly say a year, but I think it was way less than that. And then, when
that
after his wife's funeral, like, Getty and Alex were there, and He looked at him and says, "Guys, I'm done." And that's what the song Ghostwriter is about on Vapor Trails. It's literally about Neil riding on his fucking motorcycle cross country for like 4 years. Just four years of cross country biking, but he always kept in touch with Neil and Getty. He always sent him a postcard, tell him, "Hey, I'm okay. I'm just, you know, living on the land."
Is this covered in the documentary?
Yeah, it was part of the. It was on the documentary. And then he.
Oh, okay. Maybe I should check that out.
Whole documentary is great. It only goes up to Snakes and Arrows, though. Like, that's as far as it goes. But yeah. He came back in the fray around 2001, 2002. He says, "Okay, I'm ready. Let's do it." You know, and he said that when he played his first show, he had the jitters, but he never forgot how to play the chops, you know, and they said they had a great.
Well, I've always read that working is the best, you know, the best rehabilitation that you can have when you've undergone a tragedy. You just work.
And then he got remarried and had another kid.
So.
But Rush would have kept going if not for that. You know, they wouldn't have taken a break for as long as they took a 5-year break basically. It wasn't that big of a deal. But then it happened
at the time when you didn't have album sales anymore. I mean, like, yeah, Rush always even in those final records always made the top 10, but again, sales were like 100,000.
Well, they always hit gold, though. They'd always hit gold.
Canada, they go. No, not the last three. In Canada, they did. Not here. Nothing goes gold.
Yeah, you're right. Vapor Trails, freaking Snakes and Arrows, and that they hadn't gone gold yet because
they charted. They charted high. I mean, everything charts high. If I can get 5 sales of a record, you know, I have a friend named Steve, Tribulus, and he is he's a lead singer of a band called the Saints of 34th Street. And he came over and he gave me one of his records on vinyl, right? And he said it went tin, which means it sold 5 copies. So he would make a joke about that. It's really hard. I mean, you know, getting any kind of sales anymore because, you know, music is dead, as we said. Music was destroyed by the internet. There it is.
Yeah, but then Apple saved the music industry. You got to remember, things are digital sales now. Like, Apple came up with the brilliant idea of charging something that people can get for free, charging for something that people can get for free.
I think what they tried to, you remember when they tried to get people back buying products was to do special things like adding artwork and adding big box sets and all that. And that's why everything costs so much money now.
Oh yeah. That's why fucking 4K movies are costing a lot of money now. We're literally reverting back to the old VHS days to where you'd have to spend $60, you know, $60 to $80 on a tape and getting, you know, Blu-rays are becoming this, or 4K is becoming the same way. It's becoming niche. Of course, we're talking about this. We talked about how Best Buy stopped selling CDs years ago, and now they're going to stop selling DVDs and Blu-rays altogether.
But they'd still sell vinyl. It's so strange. If I want niche vinyl, I go over there. It's, you know, it's that remastered stuff. When I got my new record player, I sent Bronwyn over to the Best Buy, and I was like, find me a record, any record, anything I can break in the new record player with. So she came back with the Cars Greatest Hits or something. It was like a 4-disc set, and, you know, I popped it in, and it's all remastered and everything. And they also really fucked up one of their songs with a dumb remix. I really hated that. I hate when they go back and remix.
Sometimes I can't stand it.
Well, now, you were telling me, like, sometimes they go back to remix just to correct their horrible mistake that they made the first time, which you told me they did that with the Rush record, right?
The Vapor Trails record. They went back and remixed it because it was way too harsh, digital clipping, that kind of stuff.
Let me tell you, they need to do that with Monster. But we'll talk about Monster in a second. My ride's here. Got to pick that up. Anyway... Yeah, when they go back and they take a classic that you fell in love with maybe 20 years ago, and then they remix it, and you're like, "Oh, shut the fuck up! What are you doing?"
Well, you see, in some cases it works out well. Like for comparison's sake, when
it's "You're All I've Got Tonight."
Oh, that's
Rick Ocasek remixed "You're All I've Got Tonight," and you fucked it up.
Well, hey, really? You want to talk about some bad remixing? That started back in the '70s with ZZ Top. when remember they were on London Records for a while before they shifted over to Warner Brothers. Yeah, yeah. And then Warner Brothers came out with the ZZ Top six pack, I believe it was.
And they remixed it and fucked it up.
Was remixed with fucking reverb and all that shit. And the fans hated it.
See, that's why we have eBay. Well, go back to eBay and get those old London records. I have a couple. I have which ones do I have? I have Tejas and I have Fandango. And they sound great.
Because they're
vinyl.
The original mixes. Point is, Warner Brothers went back and corrected the mistake. They know that those remixed versions are no longer in circulation.
No, don't tell me that. I can't. Tejas is awesome. You tell me they fucked
they
it
fucked
up
it with
reverb.
A shitload of reverb. God. And it's like,
all you have to do when you're ZZ Top is turn on the fucking amplifier and play the guitar and play the drums, and it's so simple.
Now the remixes I like, we're talking about complete remix remasters, was when they went back and redid all the Genesis albums. Like, they did three different Genesis box sets. There were two Collins sets and then one Gabriel set. Okay?
Okay.
Those remixes are excellent because they have a wider sound field. There's a little bit more, some added effects for depth, and as a
all we're looking for is
it
clean.
Was very
we want
clean
it cleaner,
polished
right?
And it I love how it sounds
like Hotter Than Hell. I would love to hear a cleaned up remixed version of Hotter Than Hell, because that record sounds like shit and the songs are
recording equipment that they were using in the studio, and there's no way they can go like be like Twisted Sister. They didn't like how Stay Hungry sound. What did they do? Instead of remastering it and restoring it, they went back and re-recorded the fucking thing. It's still Hungry, and I prefer the original.
Kiss
were to do it, they'd go back and re-record it, and it wouldn't sound nowhere near as good.
They did try, though, and it's a great segue. You brought it up. When Sonic Boom came out in 2009, it was released as part of a set from Walmart. Actually, I don't know. They had a deal with Walmart, and they released a 3-disc set, which included Sonic Boom, and then a live show. But then a thing called Kiss Classics. It didn't really work out. What it was they took Tommy Thayer and Eric Singer, and Gene and Paul, and they said let's re-record these old classics. So they put like all their old stuff. The problem is that it was recorded using the same method as Sonic Boom, which means it was just loud. All they did was make loud versions of their older songs. And that's my problem with Sonic Boom right there. Paul Stanley produced it with Greg Collins, and he also produced Monster. Paul Stanley's a fine producer, but he lacks the nuance of even a Bruce Fairbairn, frankly. He lacks the nuance of Michael James Jackson or Bob Ezrin or Eddie Kramer. Mutt Lange or, you know, Ron Nevison even, or any of these guys that have a sort of signature about them. Paul Stanley's more of this hit the record button and then walk away type guy. And that's the problem with Sonic Boom. There's only like one song that I can
Modern
remember
Day Delilah
off the record after hearing it. No. Well, okay, two. All right. I'll give you Modern Day Delilah, number one. The other one was Never Enough, I think. I think that was what it was. Never Enough. Enough. Now, Monster, I can't remember a single song off that thing.
Yeah, that's a very muddy. I mean, Hell or Hallelujah
it's muddled.
Is a good song. Hell or Hallelujah.
They said that they recorded Monster on old analog equipment. They got an old mixing board, they got an old recording board, and they recorded the thing analog. But that doesn't really matter because it sounds like shit.
Because it was, we recorded it analog, but we digitally finished it.
I mean, like, you know, producers enjoy the digital experience where they can, but when it comes down to it, if they have their choice, they prefer.
Well, see, that's
analog.
What
they prefer. Working
that's what I
with
hate
tape.
About. Like, that goes back to like 4K. Like, what I don't like about certain discs. That's why I won't buy them. It's like you can shoot a movie in 4K, right? Like, you can, let's say for sake of argument, if you shoot it on film, you shoot it on film, and you can finish it in 4K and then present it on a 4K disc. That's the best way to go. My issue is. Yeah. A lot of these current 4Ks have 2K digital intermediates, and they're upscaled to 4K. And I don't, that's why I won't own Guardians of the Galaxy 1 or 2 on 4K, because it's literally finished.
It isn't just 4K, though. It's not just a 4K. It's a Blu-ray problem, too. Well, they do it, too. They port it.
Well, but then instead of just using the same digital intermediate, again, this is going to what I'm saying about, like, this Kiss Monster. Is it doesn't help the fact that, you recorded it on analog equipment. It's like the equivalent of, I'm going to shoot a modern movie on film when no one is doing that anymore. But then I'm going to make a digital intermediate out of that film print and finish exactly. it in 2K when I should be finishing it in fucking 4K. So that's the issue with Monster. It's recorded on analog equipment, but you finished it so badly on digital that you got clipping and noise distortion. And what's the fucking point? Like Paul, what was the point in recording it on analog if all you were going to do was fucking digitally clip the shit? And it does not work in its fucking favor. Yes, it's a very loud, noisy record. I don't like it either.
Yeah. And it's all anthems, too, on top of that. And it's just all, they're trying to do anthems, rock anthems or whatever. I will say, though, that both Sonic Boom and Monster do have one thing going for them. There is not one power ballad. Which is, this, at least they decided, hey, let's not do any power ballad nonsense. I was just thinking about this. Well, no. I was thinking about it for a couple of months. But pressing circumstances, I couldn't really think about it that much. But I was thinking about, there's something wrong with digital sound anyway. I really don't. I mean, I was thinking of doing a project, of doing a film project, but using a magnetic tape recorder to record the sound and then sync it up that way. And I can sync up with digital backups and all that stuff. But I was thinking, can we get back? Can we go back to magnetic sound and record onto tape? There's something about the tape. And I don't want to sound like one of those, you know, old hippies who's like, you know how I go on a
mobile
and shit. There's something about the quality of magnetic tape that it may not be necessarily better than digital. As we know, digital is very clean, but digital also lacks soul. It lacks character. Something is missing in that. I want to go back.
And you sound like one of them old VHS collectors who...
Old VHS? No, VHS is better
than
Blu-ray.
Yeah, that's exactly how you sound right now. And it's but then at the same time, I sympathize with these people. It's like... You know what? I get it. You want to go back to an earlier time. You want your film to look like shit and not cleaned up. You know, just like you want your music to have that nice old-timey sound to it, and it's too cleaned up and more or less people. Yeah.
Think about you look at old movies, right? And we're going to be looking at old movies when we do the Hammer thing. We're going to be looking at old movies, and they're going to be shot on film with in Technicolor for the most part with that kind of sound. There's a certain character to it that defeats modern movies and the way modern movies are made. Why? All these Hammer movies, like in all movies made before a certain time period, are like 90 minutes or less, you know? I look at a lot of old movies at night, and they're like, some of them are like back from the 40s and 50s, and they're like 60, 70
minutes. Oh, yeah, that's why
minutes.
I have one of the only laser discs in history that has two 60-minute movies on each side. I think it's The Black Cat and The Raven. Yeah, but then the problem is they are time compressed on each side, so there's some nasty speed up that you catch on certain scenes. There's some really nasty fucking speed up going on, but
still, there's a reason why these movies are so short. They want it, number one, film stock was very expensive. Making movies, the act of it alone, minus anything else you want to add to it, costs.
And then number
two,
you want to cram as many showings as you can get in one day.
There is that, and they made money. I mean, they made money. You put them out there. People would have watched anything.
And most of that
then,
stuff
you know?
Came out during the Depression. And the film studios were suffering as a cause of it. I mean, luckily, nobody ever really shut down because of the Depression. But at the same time, movies were shorter.
Yeah, what are we in our... We're on our 6 month of the SAG-ACTOR strike. The writer strike was solved. But the thing is, these studios aren't acting like they... Are they acting like they need money?
Yeah, well,
money right
you know, well, like they need money because, you know, the theater system's suffering. It's like, guys, you got digital. Shut up.
Everything is
and well,
well
the
right
whole
now.
The
jobs
whole main
are,
reason for
these people are unemployed. I mean, like the people who actually
right.
need
and I
their
get it.
Jobs.
The whole main reason for the strike has a meritful purpose. It's because they need to renegotiate their deals. They're like, dude, long story short, these actors aren't making anything off their streaming deals. Because the deals,
yeah,
hold on, the deals that were put in place for residuals is the key word we're looking for here, is residuals.
Yeah, yeah.
They are not getting their residuals off of most actors.
Yeah.
Like 90 to 95% of actors these days are not getting residuals from streaming. Now, shows that were done within the last, you know, 10 or 15 years, yes, they're getting residuals because of it, because those were in places in their contract. But all these old contracts that certain actors signed... they're not getting residuals off of the streaming profits. Like you know, how an artist makes money off Spotify or Apple Music, you know, X amount of cents for every stream or something like that. That's all the actors want. They want residuals from the streaming services, from the streaming content. I don't see an issue in that. I don't.
I agree with you on the streaming. I do believe that the streaming services are scamming these actors, basically. But I read a troubling statistic the other day. I read that for only 14% of actors in the Screen Actors Guild make more than $27,000 a year annually. Only 14%. That means that
that's
lower,
why I literally,
you know,
I said 90, you're near at 86, you know. Yeah,
all not making any money. None of them are making any money. I mean, the overwhelming majority of actors in the union are
and
not
it's only the
money.
Most popular not it's to live literally on runs to the most popular shows that are getting like look at Friends is probably the biggest example that you can make, because there was a reason, like, HBO ended up picking it up exclusively, and, you know, because they had to sign new deals, because all the characters in the show, all the actors, they signed new deals to get residual payments for all those old episodes.
Even though they got $1 million per episode.
They all did well from Friends going to streaming because it was, like, a really big deal because they're making money off of it. But then, okay, now you look at a show like The X-Files, which is on Hulu, right? Is David Duchovny, Gillian Anderson making any money off of this? Nope. Their residuals lie in the physical media sales, which are non-existent because...
Which is why Duchovny sued. Which, he sued in around the seventh
I mean,
season.
Unfortunately for you bought that European import X-Files set, and I guess they're making money off that on a worldwide thing. That set is still readily available and in print, but out here in the States... Yeah. The sets are not in print anymore. They took them out of print. They're in moratorium right now. So, I mean, it does suck for these guys because, yes, it's true. Streaming is the way of the future. There's still going to be a physical media market. God knows for how much fucking longer, but it is going to all transition into streaming within the next 10 to 15 years. And where are these actors going to get their residuals from the reruns? You know, This is why I'm supportive of the strike. I mean, I get where they're coming from. It ain't all about money at the end of the day. It's about your residuals. Hey, this is why I got into Hollywood and all this other stuff. This is how I'm going to make money when I'm not going to act anymore, you know? Like, look at fucking Charlie Sheen. He wasn't no dummy. He fucking got mad residuals from 2.5 Men. He's making money hand over fist from the fucking reruns. Yeah. He makes like $10 million a year off the reruns alone. And off the streaming and everything
I support the strike up to the point of these people need to get back to work, because the people that are below the line.
Well, yeah. And then for right fans like me, like right now, here's where I'm getting affected. The newest season of Chucky has just started, right? They only made 4 episodes and now that's all they're going to fucking air, because that's.
Yeah. And Cobra Kai.
Well, Cobra Kai never shot. Like they got the farthest they got on Cobra Kai was table reads. That's as far as they got with table reads. What you call it? Look at the new Deadpool movie is like 70% finished, and they had to stop mid-production. And then the cool thing is I'm glad it stopped, because now with the last 30% they can ad-lib. I think I told you about this. Like, the writer's strike was going on when they were shooting the new Deadpool, but they had to follow the script to a T. They couldn't ad-lib or do anything like that. But now, when the strike is over, when the actor strike is over and they get back to work, then Ryan Reynolds can ad lib and do what he wants to do. Do what he's good at. Mm-hmm. But that's the point. Like, these strikes do affect us as individuals, you know, like our favorite TV shows. Some shows get canceled, like the Topher Grace show got canceled, Home Economics or whatever that was, a show that a lot of people like.
Jesus, I didn't even hear about that one.
It was a quiet show on ABC, but it was very critically acclaimed, and it had a pretty decent viewership audience.
Wait, did he come out in support of Danny Masterson?
No, he was the only one who didn't. He was the only one who wouldn't write a letter on his behalf. Topher Grace, believe it or not, he's led a good life, outside of some bad acting choices. But that aside, in his personal life, he never really got along with everybody from that 70s show. Like, he went to work every day, but then when the cast wanted to hang out afterwards and everything like that and engage in debaucherous acts, he was like, no, I'm good.
battery.
Okay. So where did we leave off here? We left off with Monster being sounding like Muddle. Yeah,
well, I mean, I want to touch on Detroit Rock City a little bit because, like, we jumped a little.
All right.
We've been touching on this movie quite a bit. Like, this was, like, why we started this whole Kiss thing. This is where I became a big Kiss fan, was because of watching.
Oh, well, it wasn't just Detroit Rock City. You just mentioned That 70s Show. Kiss made an appearance in That 70s Show.
I wasn't watching That 70s Show like that around that.
There was, like, a whole night of programming on Fox on Sunday that featured Kiss. In fact, an episode of Millennium as well that featured Kiss doing their Psycho Circus thing. And each member of the band played a part that wasn't Kiss without makeup on that episode as well. So Kiss did this whole Fox thing, and it was like a big promotional bonanza.
Kiss was on fucking Family Guy twice, for Christ's sake.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, dude, it was Kiss mania for, like, between what, 98 and 2001, it was like all Kiss, all everywhere.
It was huge. They were making way more money than they had ever made before, and most of that was going into Gene and Paul's pocket. And they had Ace and Peter were not partners, and they were pissed off about that. And they were basically salaried employees at that point. And that's why Ace left. Ace was really undependable anyway. He went back to his old ways of drinking and drugs. And he didn't show up for some gigs. So they got Tommy. They had Tommy waiting in the wings with the makeup and everything. And he would come out and play the Ace part. And that's when they stopped referring to him as Ace Frehley. They started referring to him as the Spaceman, as a character. And Ace left the band. And then Peter left the band, but then Peter came back. I guess they offered him money to go on the Australian tour, and I have a DVD of the Kiss Alive 4 Symphony in Australia. And it's a great DVD, too. It's really fine. And then at some point, Peter left. So then it became just Gene and Paul, and then Tommy Thayer, and then they brought back Eric Singer to play the
part. But then they figured out it was
and
all...
Also, Eric sings. Eric sings on at least one song on each of the records on Sonic Boom and Monster.
But not Tommy.
No,
oh, really?
Tommy sings. Yeah, he sings two songs. He sings one song on Sonic Boom and one song on Monster. One of them is called Out of This World. I think that's on Monster. And the other one's called Lightning, something about lightning striking. Or I don't know. Something like that. He's not... Tommy Thayer doesn't sound like he's really... He sounds a little bit more like Gene Simmons. He's got kind of like a raspy,
little gravelly, raspy thing going on right there.
Eric does a really a decent Peter impersonation. He does that kind of raspy singing that Peter does.
Well, because they all play on Coming Home, fucking Unplugged. He was singing with me. I can't even think of it. I can't even talk straight right now because I'm still waking up. Yeah, he sang with Peter on the freaking Unplugged. And it sounded really good. And that was when they did Nothing to Lose. That's right. Fucking Eric and Peter were both singing Nothing to Lose. That's what I was thinking.
Isn't it, though? I mean, like, even Peter said, he said to Eric, I'm just going to keep time with you. You are the drummer. I'll keep time with you, but you are the drummer. So, you know. Now we got to get into like the thing. I mean, this is the thing I really hate is because I hate Kiss fans. I don't know how you feel about Rush fans.
Well, Rush fans are loyal. I mean, we're all, dude, we all get along. There's literally no division in the group. It's like the one thing that Rush fans all agree on is this: Caress of Steel is a very underrated record, but we can understand why people don't like it. At the same time, Hold Your Fire has a lot of good tracks on, like. The synth era is always considered the worst era, but there's a lot of good shit in the synth era. It's just we don't like to admit it. But I love the synth era of Rush. Like, out of the few CDs I own all of their synth CDs, like Grace Under Pressure, Signals, Power Windows, and Hold Your Fire. I own all three. I own all four. I love those records.
Okay, so we're talking 1985 through 92.
What, for Rush? No, I'm talking 82 through 87. Because, like, the synth era pretty much started with Moving Pictures, if you want to get technical, but then Moving Pictures was, like, the last album that had, like, a big 10-minute bombastic track, but then it all started going on a shorter song.
So it's kind of like Journey. Journey started really hitting those synths
right around Escape, you know, from 81 to 86 when they did Escape, Frontiers, and Raised on Radio. And Frontiers is my favorite Journey record, and it's all a lot of synth, but I like the record a lot. I think it's their best 80s album. It's better than Escape. I think, anyway.
A lot of them, actually, a lot of these bands really did go for the synth, except for AC/DC.
Yeah, they never went the synth route, thank goodness.
Chicago did, too. I remember Chicago.
All hail Lucifer, spill the blood of the innocent. Oh, man, Chicago kicks ass.
So I have to get into that terrible time. This is the terrible time when Kiss stopped being Kiss. It wasn't really Kiss. Think about it that way. Kiss died after Carnival of Souls, I want to say. You know, and then it becomes this kind of circus sideshow. It's just a revival. And this is when all the autobiographies come out and everybody hates everybody else and everybody's got the different version of the story. And the only way you could get any kind of a straight story was to go to Bill O'Coin, at least until he died. You know, when Bill O'Coin died, I mean, he was like the last one who actually knew the truth. I mean, like, Peter's like, Paul's a jerk. Gene's a jerk. Gene's like, everybody's a jerk except for me because I'm brilliant. I created Kiss. Paul is like, Ace is a dick. Peter's a dick. Gene's a dick, too. I would say probably, if you want to get as close to the truth as possible, I think Paul's autobiography is probably the most accurate because he was willing to talk about his own inadequacies. And he talked about how he was in therapy and how he was in analysis. And he grew up with a deformed ear that he got repaired. And he's deaf in one ear, you know. And he talked about how he was friends. I mean, like, Ace was like his friend. And now, I mean, like, but now it's so weird to hear him talk badmouth Ace so much. And Ace having to badmouth Paul in retaliation. It's just like, oh my God, you guys are in your 70s. Why are you behaving like this? You're behaving like fucking children. And then the Kiss fans are the worst because they take sides.
Yeah.
Instead of saying you guys are both douches for doing
you,
this.
No, you want to talk like about some derision Paul. that's been going on for over 25 years that needs to fucking die. Oasis needs to get fucking back together.
Oasis, really?
But think about it, okay? You want to talk about all these long-standing feuds that you can't patch up or nothing like that? I'm like, here's how I see it, okay? No one in a million years ever would have thought Guns N' Roses was going to get fucking back there. You know, fucking, you know, all those guys. Slash, Duff McKagan, all them guys. But yet they all put it aside, and they all got back together, and now they're friendly again. And nobody in a million years thought Guns.
They're touring.
They're still touring.
A friend of mine.
And everything. They got back together, and they patched up all their bullshit, right? You'd figure Oasis, after 25 years, could do the same, but then Noel and Liam Gallagher, they fucking hate each other. Like, you are brothers, for Christ's sake. You are blood fucking brothers. Me and my brother don't get on very well, but I don't hate the motherfucker, okay?
I think that might be the problem right there, is that the fact that they are brothers is the reason they hate each other.
I don't know, but they need to let it go. Like, they literally need to let it fucking go. Now, with Kiss, like you said, they're in their fucking 70s at this point. Like Paul is the youngest one. He's going to be 71, if not just turned 71 this year. All the other guys are in their mid to late 70s. You know, they need to just stop. It's like, guys, we're not asking you. We are not asking you to perform together one last time. We don't want that. We just want, you know, a one harmonious thing. Like, just end it on a good note. I mean, at least when they did the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame ceremony, they seemed to get on okay.
That's why I thought the best idea would be for them to do some club shows. Do club shows, but no makeup. And just the four of them, and have it be a very informal, kind of casual affair, and have them do club shows. And Kiss fans don't get it. They're like, no, no, no. We want to see them in makeup. I'm like, are you kidding me? I mean, I thought it was kind of weird and embarrassing that they were wearing this makeup. And, you know, they're in their 70s. I mean, they're still doing it. Their final show was scheduled for December of this year. And it's going to be makeup. And the thing is, there's like a whole time period where, you know, people didn't like them with the makeup and preferred them without the makeup, you know, the Lick It Up to,
yeah, Lick It Up,
you know,
yeah,
Revenge era. And the thing is, now it's just so silly. I mean, I just can't
imagine. Because then it was, you know, I guess the reason that was good for losing the makeup was it kind of showed that Kiss was actual musicians and it wasn't a fucking gimmick. I mean, now it helped that they had some good producers, some good uncredited players, and some good writers, you know, to help them out. So it, you know, Kiss became a competent band, but now you see, that's the thing about Revenge. Like, Revenge, I think, and maybe even to a lesser extent, Carnival of Souls, just shows that they're actually good musicians, that they are proficient players, But then you go back to a gimmick, and then you're going to deride your fan base again by going back to the fucking gimmick. You don't need the gimmick anymore, guys. Yeah. You're Kiss. It's like you've outgrown the gimmick. You've shown you can outgrow the gimmick. Yes, it was fine going back to makeup for the last hurrah. That was cool. You know, we hadn't done the makeup in, what, 15 years? Great. Go back to it for a little while. Just for a little bit.
It's like what we're living through right now is the longest era of one particular type of Kiss right there. Think about it this way, right? They started in 73, you know, after Wicked Lester or whatever. The beginning was like from 73 to 79, and that was like 6 years of the original lineup before Peter leaves. And then 1980, Eric joins them. 1981, and then when 1982, Frehley leaves. And then the makeup comes off in 83. So you've got like one, the original era, and then like the mini era with Eric Carr, and then a new non-makeup era from 1983 to 1997, I would say, right? Because of Carnival of Souls. That's 83 to 97 is probably the longest period they had. What was that? Oh, God. Come on. Let me think. 14 years. Okay. 14 years without makeup. And then starting in 1998 with Psycho Circus, and now, up to now, it's 25 years. 25 years of this revival era with makeup. So they spent more time with the makeup. Mm-hmm.
If you look at the set, if you look at these set lists, like I've seen a Kiss set list recently, there's barely any 80s shit in the set list. I mean, okay, Lick It Up, that's always going to be in the set list.
They did Lick It Up. I remember it was interesting. It was a novelty to see them with makeup on doing Lick It Up.
But then, like, they don't.
You know, maybe even Heaven's
on
Fire.
I think, yeah, they do Heaven's on Fire.
And Forever, of course. Yeah, they do Forever.
But me and you know there's so many more good songs from that era that they could be doing versus now you go on, it's just literally a Kiss Greatest Hits tour. But then again, with most bands these days, with most older bands, it is a Greatest Hits tour because they don't put out new shit anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
Now you see.
Yeah, none of the new crap. Just do Taking Care of Business.
Now get to the work and overtime part. Okay, I'll at least do when I saw Rush back in 2012, I will at least give them credit for how that show went. The opening part of the show was they did synth era. Like they stayed in the synth era for the most part, and then they did a couple of new-ish tracks, like they did what the fuck is that song? Far Cry from Snakes and Arrows. And then the second half of the show is where they bring out the orchestra, and then they do 10 songs from Clockwork Angels. And then when that was all over, they came back and did fucking Red Sector A, and then they did, you know, fucking Tom Sawyer, 2112, Limelight. You know, when it became like the Rush Greatest Hits show. At the very end was Rush Greatest Hits. Like they just, and when they did the 40th anniversary tour, that was Rush's Greatest Hits right there. But that was their farewell tour. They had it.
I had an interesting similar, well, not so similar, but I was a big Smashing Pumpkins fan. And Melancholy and Infinite Sadness was like their big record.
Yes, even
remember?
As a Chicagoan who is a extremely, extremely passive Pumpkins fan, my wife is the huge Pumpkins fan. I can honestly say that Melancholy was their magnum opus, and anything they did after that
was
crap.
Their masterpiece. Yes. Well, I do like Adore, okay, but the big issue was I went to see Smashing Pumpkins at Radio City Music Hall. They did like it was a special one-off charity show, and the tickets were really expensive because it was for charity. I think it were like $100, and that was a lot back in the late '90s, right? So, but for the entire show, this is when Adore came out. They performed the entire album Adore from start to finish. Everybody in the audience, we were kind of disappointed to say the least, because Adore, as you know, not as big, not as successful, not as good as Melancholy.
Yeah, and then
right?
to a lesser extent, a lot of people prefer Siamese Dream or Gish.
Oh, Siamese Dream and Gish are fucking incredible records, and you know, as a Pumpkins fan, I mean, I love that stuff. There are parts of Adore that I really like. But at the end of the show, Peter Vallone, who was like a congressman over here, he comes up on stage and he gives the band the key to the city because of their charity work and all that. And so for an encore, he decides Billy decides to do Tonight Tonight. And everybody gets on their chairs and screams because that's what they wanted to hear. They all wanted to hear the melancholy stuff. And here come the cops because they were pissed off about it too. Anyway, everybody was like, come on, do something for melancholy. What is this? And all right, hang on a second.
I know it's nice outside. All right, all right, shut that window.
it's a little warm in here. So he does the one song Tonight Tonight. And everybody applauds. Everybody was waiting for that. We were waiting for stuff. We wanted to hear stuff from Siamese Dream. And Corgan was just, you know, he's a stubborn little shit. You know how he is. And he just decides, I want to do Adore instead. So he does the whole night. And I spent $100 to listen to Adore being played live.
Yeah, well, hey, man, I spent the money to see Clockwork Angels be played live with an orchestra. And the audience loved every minute of it because it was such a good album. I mean, it was, again, you asked me.
I mean, I like Adore. I just didn't want to hear the whole night just pissed away on
you
Adore.
See, at least Rush didn't piss away the whole night. They didn't piss away the whole night. Like, they literally...
I wanted to hear Bullet with Butterfly Wings. I wanted to hear Zero. I wanted to hear Rocket. I wanted to hear, you know...
Today. You wanted to hear Today.
Today, yeah. I wanted to hear all of that stuff, too. I mean, like...
You wanted to hear Cherub Rock.
Like 2 hours. Cherub Rock. I wanted to hear all kinds of stuff. I wanted to hear, you know, it's kind of disappointing, but the thing is, it was all for charity, so, you know, whatever. I hope we fed some kids or something. I don't know.
But
it was interesting, though, because Radio City is not, it's not really a rock venue. I mean, my wife talked about how she saw the B-52s and the Pretenders. And she said everybody wanted to get up and dance, but there were people complaining because they couldn't see. And it's like, excuse me, I'm trying to listen to this music. I don't want to sit there and dance. You know, and it's like really strange because the way Radio City is laid out, it's not laid out like.
Yeah,
it's, like
I was going to say it's more
like,
of a theater than it is a concert
it's
hall.
It's not a stadium.
So, yeah. I totally, hey, you know what? When I saw Rammstein back in 2001, they played in the theater. They did not play in a music hall. They played in a theater, but we all rushed.
Did everybody just
sit
politely?
We rushed the fucking stage. I was up front.
what was really funny and sad, though, was when I saw Marilyn Manson, right, at Nassau Coliseum a long time ago, and they were supposed to be touring with Hole, and then Hole backed out, I guess, because she had differences with Marilyn Manson or whatever. So they brought in Monster Magnet and this other band, and the place was like half empty. It was obvious that everybody was there to see Courtney Love for some reason.
Ew. Like, Hole wasn't even that good of a band. Wow, they came out with one semi-decent record. And, dude, I'm not even a big Manson.
I'm not even a huge Manson fan.
Yeah.
They did, and he performed Antichrist Superstar from start to finish. It was awesome. It was incredible.
Okay, cool.
It was a good show. It was a great show, but like half the crowd wasn't there. And they even, some of the Manson publicity people were like, you guys want to come up a little bit closer to the stage because we want to fill it out a little bit. And I was like, oh my God, I feel so bad for these people.
And how long ago was this?
This was like, you know, it was before Dope Show. It was before, it was
oh, so Antichrist. It was during the Antichrist there and he played the whole record is what you're saying. Okay. Yeah, I did not. Okay. And, but then I don't know.
And I think it was probably during Celebrity Skin.
Okay, so this is right before Marilyn Manson, the Mechanical Animals album. Okay, that was before. Okay.
Yeah, it was before that, definitely.
Well, at least Kiss never had to worry about, you know, I guess that's the great thing about Kiss is regardless of your indifferences and if you're a fan or anything like that, regardless if it's the Kiss Greatest Hits Tour, every place they go, they can still sell out the mother. Well, come close to selling out the place.
Well, these days, anyway, yeah, sure. They're definitely selling out. And now they've got this thing, the Kiss Cruise, and it's just,
the Kiss Coffin. And
all that, the Kiss credit card. And the whole thing is, it's just become this kind of, it's just a corporate, it's a corporate machine designed to turn out products. And the products are not worth what they were worth. Like, can you imagine a Kiss lunchbox from 1977 and then compare it to a Kiss lunchbox from 2023? It's like, which one are you going to want? Which Kiss dolls are you going to want? Are you going to want the original Migos that they had or I mean, as cool as the Todd McFarlane Kiss action figures were, you want those original ones. And that's my final point that I want to make about this whole thing is the nostalgia factor. I don't listen to Psycho Circus, Sonic Boom.
No, neither do I.
Don't. I go back and I listen, even if it sounds like shit, I'll go back and listen to Hotter Than Hell. I'll go back and listen to Dressed to Kill. I'll go back and listen to the first record, or Destroyer, or Alive, or the solo albums even. I'll listen to that time because that's the nostalgia for me. And I think that's what people try to do. And it's interesting to me because you've got all these older 50-something, 60-something kids, guys and gals, right? But they're still kids at heart because listening to Kiss is what keeps them young. And then they bring their kids. They bring their kids to these shows. And it is a family affair now. It is a circus. And that's what, I guess, keeps you young, I guess, is going back and trying to pretend that time hasn't passed and that you're not getting older and that Kiss will always be
around
forever.
That's not just with Kiss, but that's with anything. It's like, I still think the 80s is the greatest decade there ever was, and I always try to live vicariously in the 80s by Dude, I listen to more 80s music than anything else. I watch more 80s movies than anything else. Like,
it's probably has to do with because you were younger. I think everything is better when you're younger. That's what Fran Lebowitz.
Everything
says.
Is better when you're younger.
And tell me, the first time, Frehley, the first time you got your first VCR and you took it out of the cardboard box, the family, and you popped that first tape in. Tell me that wasn't the most exciting thing.
Believe me,
that
I'm not
going
to lie to you. I remember when I got, like, I had a VCR, but it was a piece of shit little two-head guy, but it got the job done. But I remember Christmas of 98. I got a brand new – I got a Symphonic VCR back in 95. So, yeah, I've had the privilege of opening up two VCRs that were my own. You know what I mean? But I remember opening up my first DVD player back in 1999. I remember opening that up.
I was excited about that, but I don't think I was nearly as excited as I was when I got the VCR, because remember, the VCR could tape things too. You could tape them right off the TV. Now, compare that to how you feel when a new streaming service pops up, or a new piece of technology, or a new computer, or a new Blu-ray player, or something like that. It's not the same, because there was something about you when you were young and you opened up a new thing and you discovered it on your own. And there was so much cool stuff like Atari, the Atari video game system. Yeah. It's not as great as all the PlayStation, Xbox stuff that's out now, but it was incredible.
Well, considering how much you look at inflation, how much one of them costed back then and what it would cost now. It was like, I think it was like the Atari was like $200. The original 2600 VCS was like $200. In 1976,
when you didn't have that
and nobody
kind of money,
had that kind of money. But then comparatively speaking, you look at how much the first VCRs cost. Didn't matter if it was a JVC VHS or Sony Betamax.
Seven,
they're like $1,000 for a VCR. And
huge.
And then you could
look
at this way.
Like,
you could buy a car. You could buy, in 1976, you could buy a damn good fucking car for that kind of money. You know, so what's more important, a vehicle or time shifting, recording television? You know, and it's hard to fathom that families had to think about that shit back in the latter part of the 70s, you know?
And that's why we marvel at those things. We marveled at those things because we were young. There was a lot less space in our heads to be occupied by other things. We didn't worry about the things we worry about now. You know, I have a kid. I worry about the world. I worry about all kinds of stuff. I'm tired, you know. I need a lot of sleep. I try to watch, you know. And now I'm trying to go back and look at those movies I never got to see before. So I'm looking at a lot of old stuff and I'm liking it. I'm actually liking all this old stuff that I never would have liked when I was younger now, because that's the closest thing you have to discovery now. Is watching stuff you would have never given a second thought about.
That's what happens when you get older. Your tastes get refined. I remember the first time I tried to watch Clockwork Orange, I didn't like it, but then I revisited it a few years later, and then my taste got better. And I'm like, okay, you know what? This is a great fucking movie. What the hell was wrong with me? I could say the same about Fight Club. I did not impress me upon first watch. I waited 5 years, and I'm like, okay, this is a great fucking movie. And then another one was the Big.
Another one was the Big Lebowski. Great.
The first time I saw Big Lebowski, I didn't get it. I was just like, okay,
I've, I didn't like it either. That one I did really enjoy upon...
Yeah, further rewatches.
And also, I hate the fucking Eagles.
My head hurts, I have split heck, and I hate the fucking Eagles, man. It's... Again, when you're young, when you're a young person, you're a young kid, you don't get it. And then the older you get, it's like, okay, I get it now. You know, and that's what time does. Time, as the old expression goes, time heals all wounds, time fixes most mistakes. You know, and it is what it is. So I'm glad we get to go back and relive some things. I mean, at least with Kiss, we get to, you know, relive the old nostalgia. At least we're not that far off the later shit. We just don't, we'd rather not listen to any of the newer shit. I mean, Psycho Circus, it's okay for what it is, but I don't listen to it. I don't listen to Monster. Yeah. I don't listen to Sonic Boom. I would rather go back and listen to Hot in the Shade because, you know, I'd rather go back and listen to that.
That's
weird.
Right?
That's like the worst album of the 80s era, and I'd still rather listen to that.
Yeah, it was the worst, but at least you felt like it was pure. You felt like at least they were just trying to do it just because they were having fun doing it. Now, it's all this corporate stuff going on, and it's just terrible. It's just terrible.
I mean, hell, like most bands from my era, like a band I used to really like, Disturbed, they freaking jumped the shark when they, like, as they went on hiatus back in, like, 2010, they went on a 5-year hiatus, and they came back with another record, and two of them sucked. It was, I don't even remember them. I don't even want to know them. They were just terrible records. One of them had that Sound of Silence cover, which is god-awful.
Wait, which one?
It was freaking, Immortalized. That was the name of the record, was Disturbed, Immortalized, and it had the cover track to The Sound of Silence.
Is that Sound of Silence that is really, like, big and dramatic and screaming, and it's, oh, my God. They used that on an episode of The Blacklist, and I was like, Jesus Christ, this is horrible.
And
why would you do that to the song? The song is,
you see, because Disturbed, at one point in time could do good covers. Like, they did the Land of Confusion cover, which is really fucking good. They did the cover of Shout, which is really fucking good. They did a, when they played in Music as a Weapon, they used to play Fade to Black live, and they did a really good job playing Fade to Black. But then they did this fucking Sound of Silence cover, and it's just like, no. For God's sake, no. Don't quit your day job. And then the next record that came out was even more trashy. But then they've righted the ship a little bit. Their most current record, which came out about a year or so ago, actually is what I would call a return to form for Disturbed. It's like a lot better than the two albums we got. But, you know, another band that sold out really quick, Shinedown. Their last great album was The Sound of Madness from 2009, 2010. Anything they've come out with after that is garbage. So, I mean, I guess we've been all talking about Rush here. You know, we've been talking about Kiss, we've been talking about Rush. This is why Rush is my favorite band, because of the level of consistently good music they come out with. They may have a misstep every now and again, but at least they strived for a level of consistency.
You know what? You know, maybe we can do, somewhere in the future, we can do a Rush show, and I can go and listen to this, because like I said, I'm only a fair weather Rush fan, in that I know a couple of the records and a couple of songs. I don't really know the history, and I could go back and look at those. I could go and go through the whole catalog, and we can talk about it from the point of view of a seasoned Rush guy and a novice who knows nothing about the band. And I can tell you, I can give you my thoughts.
I would love to do something like that, because that's like, again, Kiss is one of your favorite bands. Rush is my favorite. Yeah, maybe next summer. Like, Rush is my favorite band, and I could talk ad nauseum about Rush. Ad nauseum. I could. I mean, hey, man. You got Rush fans, and you got deadheads. Would you rather me be a Rush fan or a fucking deadhead?
There's the title.
I'm not a deadhead.
As Paul Stanley once said, any band with a member named Pigpen, please. We could call it Rush Ad Nauseam.
There you go.
Hey, because that sounds, Ad Nauseam sounds like a Rush, the title of a Rush record.
It would be.
Anyway.
Well, like they said, what was it? Ad Nauseam, when they did the Caress of Steel, it was called the Down the Tubes Tour, because they thought they were going to break up.
Okay. Well, maybe we'll do that. But first, we are going to go back to Frelix, upstairs at Frelix, which is ironic because he lives in a single story. And we're going to do Hammer, I guess.
Yeah, I got a lot of homework I got to do, but
there's a lot of homework, but it'll be a lot of fun, I guarantee it. I guarantee you.
Some of these movies I actually have on like Laserdisc or Blu-ray or DVD. Some of these movies we're going to do. I have some of them, but most of them I don't.
If you want, I can send you some stuff.
Yeah, or hopefully it's on some sort of streaming service. Maybe if some of this shit's on like Screambox or Shudder, maybe I'll get like a free trial just so I can watch shit. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. If not, I can, you know, I found a lot of stuff I do. But otherwise, let's finish up Kiss and let's just say, okay, this is like the end of the road for us. And
they swear this is the fucking end of the road for them. And you know what I say? It damn well better be, because... Now, you know what it's going to be called after? It's going to be called the Beating a Dead Horse Tour. If it's not the end of the road, it's called Beating a Dead Horse.
Well, you'd think that Guns N' Roses would have taken that one and trademarked it.
You'd think. But you know what? Hey, give them credit. They got back together when no one thought they ever fucking would, okay? I am not the biggest Guns N' Roses fan.
Yeah, I was a little bit shocked about that.
But
wait, I forgot to ask, because I asked, because a friend of mine, Alex, was going to see their show. And he said that he knew that Axl and Slash were there, but he didn't know if anybody else was there. Is anybody else?
Tracy
else
Gunn, Duff McKagan, man.
Wait, Guns?
Yeah, well,
from
it's
LA
always
Guns,
been. What is it? Duff McKagan.
Wait, what
about
Izzy
Stradlin? He's there.
What about? I don't know. Is
Stephen
Adler?
Yes, Stephen Adler. That's right.
Died?
Stephen Adler, Izzy Stradlin, Duff McKagan—they're all there.
Wow. So they really did all actually get together? Well, what about the other guy, Matt?
I don't know about that. No, it's the original OG line.
Because he did leave. Because I remember Steven Adler left because he had drug issues. Apparently, he was doing too many drugs for Guns N' Roses. You're like, dude, you do too many drugs.
Let me make sure. I can look up the current band member list real quick. Band members. And, oh, here you go. Okay, to answer your questions. Current members: Axl Rose, Duff McKagan, Slash, Dizzy Reed, Richard Fortus, Frank Farrar, and Melissa Reese. Okay, so no Izzy Stradlin,
Dizzy
and no Steven Adler.
Is Dizzy? He's a keyboard guy, right?
Keyboards.
Is Dizzy a keyboard guy, or was he there replacing? Or did he replace Izzy? I forget. Anyway, bring back Peter Criss and Ace Frehley and do like a couple of shows without makeup and just have a good time, man. That's what it should be about. Not hate. Music is about love. It's about getting together. It's about fellowship. It's about bringing people back, and you know they would come back. They would come back just to see the four of them. Doesn't even matter if they're wearing makeup, you know. And please don't wear makeup anymore. Stop it. Stop it with the platform shoes and stop. You're hurting yourselves when you do that. Gene Simmons broke his hip. He had to sit down. It looks
well,
so
then look
sad.
At how many hip surgeries freaking Paul Stanley's freaking had.
Yeah, you know, I mean, like Paul Stanley, he actually got his moves from belly dancers. He went to these famous belly dancing twins, and they taught him how to move his hips, and he wound up breaking them.
But then you look how high he always lifted his leg, and it's just like, yeah, you wonder why you got hip problems, man. I can't even fucking... can't even lift my legs that fucking high. Jesus.
Yeah. All right.
Well, it's been
Let's
real. It's been fun. And I think it's been real fun. Even though we've had a few setbacks because of life, dude. That's what sucked.
Life and bad audio equipment. But this is going to turn out really nice. I know it is. Anyway. All right. So take care. Like, share, and subscribe. And we will be back at some point. Maybe, I don't know, maybe next year, the end of winter.
End of winter. We can get our shit together and we can start. You know, you'll get all this shit out and then we can start our hammer cast for winter. All right. Take it easy, guys.